Special programs on BCTV are supported by the following. Keystone Property and Asset Management provides expert care of industrial, office, retail, and medical sites. With more than 4 million square feet managed, Keystone knows how to save you money.
Good evening and welcome to Diversity of Wider Vision. I'm Joseph Amprey, and I have two wonderful guests. I have Brian Twyman, a former city councilman and a social worker. I have Rebecca Reppert, who is a former teacher. For 15 years, she taught actually 20 years. She taught Navajo and Apache. She also has her own Blackfoot Native Indian blood, as well as European and African American blood. I'm saying good evening to you because you're watching me on Monday evening, December the 14th. Although actually we're taping this on Friday, the 11th at 3 p.m. thanks to the magic of BCTV. Let me say again, as I told you the last time we talked about Native Americans, that when Christopher Columbus landed in the Western Hemisphere, he was sailing for Spain, although he's Italian, and he was trying to find a Western route to Asia. So he thought he was near India. He saw these people who he thought were Indians. And so since that time, we have erroneously called Native Americans Indians, although we sometimes differentiate between East Indians and West Indians, but that's what has happened. It wasn't until later that another Italian named Amerigo Vespucci said, no, this is not Asia. This is in fact a new world. And so we began to be called America after Amerigo Vespucci, so we have North and South America, and that's why we have got our name. And beautiful Rebecca's on now. We can see Rebecca, so people will see who they're talking to. So Rebecca, please share with us some of your experiences out west with our Native Indigenous people.
Hi, I wanted to share some information on the full circle here, the progress. And what I wanted to do is specifically really not talk too much about my teaching right now, but about what has happened after 30,000 years of Native Americans living on the continent. And touching on some things that people might not realize. The other day I turned on the TV and there I saw Ed or someone's wild edible plant show. And he was eating exactly, this is a white man, who was eating exactly the same kind of plants that natives eat. So it came to my mind, you know, right now, especially during COVID, we're doing some very traditional things that are very much part of Native American value system. Extended family living, homeschooling, this popular trend toward wild edible foods, sustainability, and prayer. And you've all heard the attitude of gratitude. Wow, that sounds awfully familiar to me. And since Joe mentioned, I'll just say I was mostly living in North Central Arizona for those years. I am a native of Redding and Berks. I love my home area, but I did choose to work out west for a number of reasons, and I loved it. And I hope I can go back sometime. But I want to talk today about the full circle. Natives of all tribes really love that image of the circle, and I'm going to just try to conduct it this way. If I could start with a little quote from Chief Joseph, just a short one. The earth is the mother of all people, and all people should have equal rights upon it. This was said by him in 1879. And wow, folks, we're just now sort of starting to really respect Mother Earth and appreciate it, but also the people that we have. This is a show about diversity, and we're starting to talk about Black Lives Matter and Trans Lives Matter and all these other things. So the Native Chiefs had that vision already over 100 years ago. Anyway, if you smoke tobacco, eat corn, wear moccasins, you're doing things that are courtesy of Native Americans. If you have eaten deer and turkey and cranberries and rice for your Thanksgiving dinner, you had what would be a very classic North American Native dinner in the Northeast, of course. Milestones. I wanted to mention this as a former teacher. Because I saw the curve. When I first started in Arizona about in the 80s, I'm guessing here a little, but you can research it. They were about 30% percentile rank in Arizona for their state testing, the high school kids. They went all the way up to 60% by the time I left, and that was in math. In reading, they were at about 40 or 50th percentile, and now they're up at 70 and 80th percentile. So the educational gains have been tremendous due to the hard work of the staff, you know, the different staff, both native and non-native, but that's a milestone. Right now we're looking at, we have the National Poet Laureate of the United States, Joy Harjo, is a native of Oklahoma. I even taught her poetry in my English class, and now she is the Poet Laureate. First time a Native American has that honor. And that's fantastic. And then Joe Biden just tapped a Laguna Pueblo woman to be Secretary of the Interior. And if you know anything at all about the history of Natives with the government, boy, that's a huge step. And he said he wanted to make his cabinet look like and reflect the face of America. So now we've got some Native people in there, one anyway. So these are great milestones. Let's see. Native Americans comprise 3% of the whole American population. Only 1% lives on reservations. In other words, 2 out of 3 Native Americans are urban Indians. So how are they coping and what are they doing? And I'm gonna get to that. But I wanted to jump back into history for a minute. In 1619, you know, the famous Native American Squanto, Pawtuxet Indian, who was captured and taken to England. Then he came back to America. Then he got captured and was made a slave in Spain. Then he finally got back home again to Massachusetts. 1619, he came home, tried to go back, and his whole entire village had been wiped out by smallpox. So I mention this because we're in a pandemic right now. And of course, some people are mourning the loss of relatives. But, you know, we think it's bad now. It was pretty bad. The worldwide smallpox epidemic, or excuse me, New World smallpox took out 50 million people, estimated between 25 and 50 million people in the New World of all races. And they wiped out 90% of the Native population just about with smallpox just by itself. So yes, the pandemic is serious, but we've already started the history of our country with a very serious sweep of illness. So, .. What did this one man do? To give you an example, he became a diplomat and an interpreter, and he became the go-between person between the pilgrims and Chief Massasoit. And in 1621, in the fall, in November, they had their first Thanksgiving. All right, so that part was good. 1 year later, he died of a fever. So that was sort of the end of his time, you know, in the U.S. with that role. But anyway, he was a very outstanding American. And we talk about reconciling political divisions in our country and also between America and some other countries. We need more Indian diplomacy. If you read the speeches of the early chiefs and of the later chiefs, they were famous for their oratory, and we can still learn from that. They have something to tell us even today. One of the famous books that some of us grew up with in the 70s was Black Elk Speaks. Black Elk was a Lakota Sioux medicine man, and that's a familiar title to some people. You should look at that book again. It has a lot of amazing stories in it. And one of the things that I believe he said, if I'm not mistaken, is that we all just want happiness. That's what people want at the end of the day, no matter who you are, what color, what nationality. We would like peace and happiness. So another thing that I wanted to share quickly about things from the past, the expression bury the hatchet. That was one of the chiefs who said that was in Pennsylvania chief, by the way, but the one that I found was a Shawnee orator called Misawiakiwa, and he said that in 1759, as the Shawnee realized they're losing the French and Indian War. And he said, you know what, let's just bury the hatchet. No more fighting, no more bloodshed, enough already. He did surrender to the English. this has gotten into our American lingo, this idea of burying the hatchet between two bitterly opposed sides. So as I talk about the full circle, I'm bringing in things from a couple hundred years ago, but they're relevant today. Moving straight along to something a lot more contemporary. I know I'm going fast, but I only have a few minutes, so I'm trying to go along here. Really, for Native people on the good side, there has been just an astonishing turnabout. There are now dozens of tribal colleges from which I think I read more than 80% of Native people graduate from those colleges. There is a great respect for tribal names. You don't say someone's Indian anymore. You actually call them by their their exact tribal name. In the case of Navajos, they are called Diné. That's their name that they have for themselves. And all the other tribes have their own names as well. I couldn't believe it when I turned on the Macy's Parade, if anybody watched that. There was the Wampanoags giving the opening song and prayer for the whole Macy's Day Parade. What, you know, we've come a long way. We really are seeing Natives now as part of, as Joe Amprey would say, the wider diversity. They were included in that. I thought that was great. Something also recently on television about a cooperative effort between the Traverse Band in Michigan, in Traverse City, Michigan. They're trying to reclaim a river, take away the dam and reclaim the river and make it back to the way it used to be. Evidently that was a successful project, and I just wanted to, I think this is by one of the tribal members up there, the Chippewa tribe is what they are up there, Otto and Chippewa. I think finally, Native and non-Natives can work together for the same goal. I thought that was a great quote, and it's very simple. And they did achieve that with the local whites and the Native tribal people working together, they accomplished that goal. If only, you know, it could be so perfect elsewhere. But anyway, another thing to point out, as I said, is with the great young generation who has mastered technology. Chata Gould is one that I read out. He's an urban filmmaker out of the Bay Area in San Francisco. And I'll tell you that site in a second here. Let me just tell you it, but it's fascinating. It was a Guardian article from the British newspaper, The Guardian, and the name of the article, which you can Google, is called "Most Native Americans Live in Cities, Not Reservations." And they featured was Chata Gould, who's a filmmaker, who's typical of this generation telling their own story. They don't need, you know, a white interpreter anymore sitting next to them writing down their words. Those days are over. The young folks today can do it themselves, and they are doing it. Okay, so that's just one example. And if you go on to that site, you can see 10 or 15 other young folks doing different things in the arts, creative performance things, and in the arts world, how they're expressing themselves. How is it to live in two worlds? How is it to be Native, sort of kind of keep your identity, and yet, of course, be living in the modern American world? So when I taught out West, I let the kids write essays about that. And it's called Living in Two Worlds. What does that, how does that feel? What does that mean for you as a kid? What does that feel like? Then for me, I also had to walk in two worlds because I came from here, my home area, as a Pennsylvania Dutch kind of upbringing partly, and learning my Native things out of books. So I learned it as I was going by living there. And I really enjoyed it a lot. I learned a lot from them and their culture. All right, enough about that. So I hope I mentioned a few things that are hopeful. The other thing to mention is the nation's longest running tribal language newspaper is Akwesasne Notes, which is Iroquois up in New York State. They've had that paper for decades. That's in their language. And it's amazing to me, keep their language and culture going in spite of all the efforts at acculturation and, quite honestly, brainwashing. You know, it's just amazing, but it has happened. There's Hopi students who speak Hopi. There are Navajo students who still can speak Navajo. And I was living in one of the more traditional areas where they did. It's a huge reservation. Okay, I just saw a TV show last night about this man, this white man who has traveled all over the Americas, and it's called Living in the Americas. If you're all interested in peoples and travel, that is a great program, and they did a whole bunch of the series in a row. And anyway, he talked about the imperiled tribes of Latin America, and as some of us know, Guatemala, some of the poorest people in the hemisphere are the Guatemalan Indians. If you want to do something to help Indians, go travel to their country, to their lands, and buy their products. It will help them a lot. This is what came across in his show. They do sell for the tourist, and this is what they want to do. It's, no one's making them. They want to do it. They desperately need the money to buy back their own land, which right now they're being pushed off of because of oil and gas and forestry. And again, you can look into all that if you're at all interested in that kind of stuff. But time to, you know, go to schools, get the computers, get the things, and close the digital divide and all that. But this is not true for a lot of other Native tribes in other parts of our hemisphere. So, 2 minutes? 1 minute? Okay. Okay. I'll wrap it up. I want to say, Bamapi, that was, I guess I'll see you again. That's Chippewa or something from that tribe up there. And I'll conclude. I guess I'm being given my 5 minute warning. So thanks for listening. And that's my piece.
I have a question for you, Rebecca.
Yes, sir.
You were amongst the Navajo and the Apache, and they've always been called red men. Would you say that that's a misnomer? If you could generalize about the appearances of Native Americans, would you say there is a generalization, or is that something unfair to even try to do in terms of what they look like? Would you say they
I understand. No, they were not reddish in color. They were actually more white, pale white, or some were brown. Uh-huh. It depended, really.
Yes, but to call them red men is a misnomer, you would say, based on what you saw.
Yeah, I'm not sure where that actually came from. It might have possibly even been from the painted red that the Eastern tribes then painted themselves red. But there's a huge diversity in skin color among tribes. But as a whole, Navajos are sort of, I don't know, maybe light tan or something. Yeah, they're not red.
Well, Rebecca, can I chime in, Dr. Amprey? Rebecca, could you speak really briefly about the prophecies that are beginning to come true in terms of a lot of what you have been speaking about, the full circle of the culture coming back to where it's very important to us right now and in moving forward as a people, human beings. Can you speak to that? I know that someone most recently spoke to me about a book they read, and I don't want to misquote or misname, but I believe it was the seventh prophecy. And when you read it, it's like, wow, to know that that is kind of where we are. I don't know if you could speak.
Maybe I should do specific, who does it follow, you know, the thing with the crystals and the stones and the circle, and you know,
Becca, I mean, can you go back?
I really don't.
No, we got disconnected. Go, we couldn't hear a word you said.
I think we've lost her sound-wise, unfortunately, so it's unfortunate, but perhaps we can research that, and at a later date, we can come back with an answer to that question about the full site. I think that's an important question. And so I'm going to write that down and then we can come back to that because I think we've lost Rebecca on sound, unfortunately.
Yeah, and I just wanted to add that, Dr. Amprey, because there's a lot of things that she mentioned that are so apropos right now, you know, and she has mentioned what was originally the main culture of the people, the main belief of the people. And it's almost like if we would have listened in the first place, you know.
One of the things that's important also is the fact that the Native American culture is one that is collectivistic, that the group is more important than the individual.
Yes.
And that's been a big difference because the North American and Western European cultures, one, focus on the individual. And now there are people in both cultures who tend to focus more individually or focus more collectively. But the basic culture of Native Americans is one of collectivism and where the group is much more important than the individual. And there's an importance about transcendence and peace and harmony,
also
in harmony with nature. And one of the things that I think is unfortunate is that we have tended to destroy our environment today. Too many fossil fuels. We are facing global warming problems that would not have occurred if we'd followed the trends of Native Americans.
I'm also gratified
to hear Rebecca talk about the foods that we eat now. Some of the food, the corn. I think corn was given to the whole world by Native Americans, and the cranberries and some of the things that we're eating, I guess, were, you know, beans or some of their foods. I'm glad to hear that that's happening.
Yeah.
Go ahead, Rebecca. Give it a shot again.
I'm so sorry we can't hear her. She's had a rough time with the unfair.
Yeah, we're struggling out here, Doctor, but we're trying our best. It's almost reflective of where we are in our time with COVID, huh?
Yes, and one of the greatest problems in our world today is that we are not listening to each other. We're not communicating.
Right.
We're not trying to listen and learn and grow from each other rather than trying to put forth our own personal views. Let me ask you some questions, Ryan, because you have really been a champion of diversity. You're also a champion of the conservation of our environment, and you're a social worker. And I guess if I could ask you if there's one thing that stands out in your experiences in terms of both your work with the environment, in terms of conservation, nature, and with people, what are some things that you really have felt strongly about recently in terms of diversity from that regard?
I love that wide open palette, let's call it a palette, that you've given me to start to talk about some of these things. And, you know, first of all, my name is Brian Twyman, native to Reading. I went to St. Joseph's Elementary School, Central Catholic High School, on to Bloomsburg University and to Marywood University for my master's. All that means nothing other than I'm a student, you know, and I want to be a student to life. And it's the message that I try to pass on to people and most directly to children as I work with them in the community as a social worker. And, you know, even to speak to what Rebecca has said in what she spoke before, it's always going to come full circle. And our children is where it's at, the next generation. And, you know, I always joke around whenever I'm talking with people in my age category, I call them all babies. You know what I mean? They're babies in 18. They're still babies. They're still young. They're still learning. And one other thing that I know is instrumental in the Native American culture is the wisdom of the elders. And it's so important that we listen to what our elders are saying too. And I think generationally, yeah, there you go. She's showing a nice picture of where we're coming from. I like to be part of that vessel. You know, that kind of speaks to the connection of those things. As far as what has been important for me for diversity, I'll hit it on a couple of things that you just said. I have my background in permaculture. I had a group, a nonprofit called Permacultivate, in which we capitalized in plants and permaculture. Now, permaculture, simply put, is knowing the diversity and the importance of native plants or native species or just whatever is important in the whole environment. Like you mentioned before, the collective. Same thing when I started and took that and transcended that into being a vice president of Reading City Council. I had the same perspective. How can we collectively improve what's happening here for the people in the community? I sat on the diversity board, and just a plug to the city of Reading, you know, we have a diversity board, but sometimes we lack individuals on these boards. So a quick plug to the city of Reading, anybody who's watching this show or catches it and who's interested in diversity, it might be you, Rebecca. We need more people to be able to have all of our views of all of our perspectives of all of our lives introduced and in the arena where democratic decisions are made. So I think that's important too. As far as my life, I love this palette that we live in called America. And America is the ultimate expression of diversity. You know, we just cannot forget to ignore our history. And it has taken all of the races, so-called races, to come together and make America what it was. And at this time in our development as a young nation, I hope that we can figure it out. Because it's going to take all of us and every input that we all can give to each other to make it work from here. And it's, you know, if this isn't a big one of the bigger challenges to our society at this point, I don't know what else is. And I love the palette of diversity because it reflects on every different level of our lives. You know, what would it be so boring to have just one kind of person, one kind of color, one kind of language? We have them all. It's beautiful. We don't just go out to eat to have the one thing every time, every single day. It just doesn't make sense. And when you can incorporate all those things, you know, I'm sure Da Vinci and Michelangelo and those wonderful artists of the before, they didn't just say, all right, well, I'm just going to use black and I'm just going to use white. How about that? Let's think about life like that. You know, let's think about what we're missing because we're missing a shade. We're missing a color. We're missing an angle. We're missing a perspective. Mm-hmm. And diversity is all of that.
Yes. Oh, well said.
Hey, we can hear you, Rebecca. We're back. Good.
Oh, we're back.
Yeah, hey, you're back, Rebecca. Rebecca, jump in.
Well, yes, there were so many languages lost. One of the sad things about speaking about diversity is just the diversity within the Native community. So again, I honor the fact that they struggled hard to keep hold of it because language does reflect your thinking and expresses your thinking. And they do have a more, you know, it's a different way of expressing things, and there's more, maybe a little more subtlety in the language. Can I give you one example? I have to tell you this because we're in COVID, and this hit me the other day. It hit me the other day.
We can still hear you, Rebecca.
We still hear you, Rebecca. You sound, you're coming in well.
Maybe it's our BCTV team that's cutting in a little bit there, Doctor.
Yes. Rebecca, if you can answer a question for me, one of the things that I used to watch a lot of Cowboys and Indians, I think it may have been distorted, but one of the things you talked about was smoke singles. While you were out in Arizona and did they ever do anything, but did they ever send any messages through smoke singles? Is that a practice? It's no longer practiced, but I got the impression that that from one group to another, they could do certain things with fire and smoke and send messages. Is that still take place, or is that perhaps a skill that's no longer used?
Yeah, so Doc, I think she might have cut out to regroup, and I think that's wonderful. That's a great question, Doctor. There she is.
Yeah, I'm sorry it went off.
That's perfect.
I have to tell you, I met Sherman Alexie. I heard him giving a talk in Durango at the college. He was hilarious. He's the author of the modern book, the humor book, Smoke Signals, and many other humor books. He's so funny. But no, the actual practice of sending signals would have gone back to warfare practices of the 1800s. Uh-huh. Maybe the middle of the 1800s, that stuff ended because people were on horseback and so forth and so on. And yes, you can see the smoke from far away. And yes, I guess they did. I'd have to look into that a little more, but I think that would be about right to get messages from far
away. I also think that horseback riding became very popular in this country, I think because of the Native Americans. Did you see any horseback riding when you were west?
Yes. I went to rodeos, powwows, and yes. Now, obviously, everybody drove a pickup truck to go to town everywhere. But I'll tell you one thing. For Mother's Day, they had a horse race. And this was the one time you would see Navajos actually racing their horses, which was so exciting. Uh-huh. It was right across the highway from where I lived. The school and where I lived was on one side of the road. And on the other side was this long field, but the desert area. And they had it along that. Uh-huh. That was really cool. Yeah, that's true. That when Navajos got horses, they raced them. Yes.
Uh-huh. Did you see any teepees?
No. That's not the country where I, no, hogans were the houses of Navajos. Hogans and trailers, you know, for modern living and some stucco.
Would you describe hogans? What do they look like?
Yes. A hogan is a mud house with pine beams inside. I should know this by now. I think there's 16 pine beams. Anyway, it's an even number. The house is always, the doorway always faces east. So uh-huh. you will get the light of the rising sun, and also you pray to the sun father in the morning uh-huh. with your corn pollen. So it's always important to have that facing east. But anyway, it can hold maybe up to 10, 15, you know, 10 people or so just sleeping on the floor. Wow. Now, a hogan will have a wood stove in the middle, a wood burning stove in the middle, a whole uh-huh. smoke hole at the top. So that air is always there, but it closes up tight and snug because the walls are thick. So actually it's pretty cool in the summer and warm in the winter.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's great. I'm going to shift the focus a second to Brian. Brian is a son of a nurse, a registered nurse. And of course, we are so focused on health these days. Right. Brian, anything you want to pass along that your mom may have given you in terms of health in general and also in combating the COVID?
Well, definitely, you know, we can speak to the practices that we live and how they reflect what's happening with COVID right now. And you know, my mother has always been a champion of prevention medicine. Uh-huh. So in terms of that is, you know, recognizing that our food and our nutrition seriously affects our health. And that is where we need to start to be aware of. And, you know, I'm a champion of making sure that you're eating healthy, drinking healthy, and exercising healthy in order to combat, you know, what we're living in right now. Now, that being said, we also need to really pay close attention to what's happening in our society and the regulations that are put down through the state and the CDC and, you know, best practice protective practices for everyone. So my mother just always was ahead of things in terms of what she wanted to do and what she wanted for us. So she always taught us like, hey, look, you know, you have to take your vitamins. If sometimes you're not receiving the right nutrition from the food you're eating, you need to supplement and you need to do what you need to do to get your exercise. We were always active. So, you know, that's one side of it. Uh-huh. I call myself a practitioner of good health currently because I teach people about the importance of drinking water, the importance of exercise, the importance of the other side of my profession, which is mental health. And how all these things are, again, in that circle. They all come together into making sure that you as a being is healthy or are healthy. Because there's so many things that we are challenged by in our environments, natural and outside, that sometimes we're not aware of. So, you know, you can only do your best to be preventative in ways to eat healthy. So, you know, maybe your weight is down a little bit. Exercise so that your body is able to adjust to change and you can breathe and you can actually, you know, have a good resting heartbeat or non-resting heartbeat in that you know that you're healthy. You know, the other challenges of COVID right now is like the things that I'm saying, it's hard. You know, some people are really gym people and the gyms are closed. You know, some people might not want to go outside, they might be a little bit fearful. So how do they get that exercise in their home? Those are all the challenges of COVID. And my mother being a nurse, we always talk about it. And we are as dumbfounded as everyone else about what are the right ways or what are the right steps to go about, you know, handling this. And I think they're doing a good job. in the preventative steps with the masks. I've been in countless schools in the county of Berks, and it's super impressive to see that there's one or two school districts in the school that are really doing it. There's children in these schools right now, and there's no breakout of cases. Everyone's calm. The children are actually learning. I think it's so exciting because we have to be able to look at these models that are created and pick for ourselves if they work or not. And in the diversity of thought, in the diversity of what's happening in our world today, we need to hear them all. So a lot of people are hearing, you know, to be fearful and scared. It's more that we need to be preventative and safe, but not realize that there are good things still happening. I want to share that there are some schools going on, and everybody's okay, you know, for now.
Thank you for the good news. I will share with you also, I've been very concerned about diet. And of course, I try to eat lots of vegetables, lots of fruits.
Yes.
And unfortunately, most of the things I like most are not good for me. I love ice cream. I love red meat. Yeah. I have to be in moderation. I will share with you this, something I started about 6 years ago, and it worked. I lost weight at first. There's a very prominent doctor named Sanjay Gupta, who's on all the time. He is he's an American, but his roots are Indian, East Indian. He said years ago, and I listened to what he said, eat breakfast like a king, lunch like a prince, and dinner like a pauper. So after hearing that, I begin to eat my biggest meal in the morning. So I get up in the morning and have a real big meal, maybe some chicken and some brown rice and some green vegetables. And then lunch is much less, and dinner is even less with fruits in the evening. The only thing I don't like about that, because I'm obsessed with food, and I've had my big feast in the morning, I'm kind of upset later on when I'm saying, oh no, I've already had the good stuff. But when I first did this, I actually lost weight, and I practice it. Now, when I'm around family and friends, to be sociable, I'll eat the big meal late, which is normally in the evening with them. But since I live alone, and oftentimes I will crock pot something on one day and have it for 3 or 4 days, reheat it up. And of course, the other thing I think is interesting is that we have been so craving instant results, instant success, that oftentimes we don't like things that are cooked slowly. I find that if I cook a chicken slowly, crock potting overnight, it's so tender, the meat falls off the bone. And of course, I found the same thing too with turkey. And I love my greens, but instead of seasoning with fatback, which is pork, I season with smoked turkey. I get the same great flavor. So those are things I've done in terms of food wise. And I try to eat an apple every day, an orange every day, a carrot every day, and some grapes every day. And I find that these fruits help my metabolism. And of course, lots of water also helps, because they say water really, we should drink 6 glasses a day. So these are some things I can pass along that you probably already know in terms of watching our diets.
And I love that you're putting it out there for people. Again, you know, Dr. Avery, I'm going to keep it on diversity, because that's what you need. Sometimes you need diversity in your diet, and you have to recognize that there's different ways to eat. And, you know, bringing it back to culturally, some cultures really generally eat better than other cultures. And what's been popular now in the Americas has come to be like a more Indian diet, some of the Indian diets and the Mexican diets. Now think about the basis of those diets. They're based on cultures that are very sustainable. I mean, they use whatever they can get in their environments. And back to even the Chinese diet, lots of rice. Those are things that are accessible to them. And they use them as sustainable diet pieces until they become culture. You know, if you looked at America and came here, you saw everybody eating spaghetti and pizza, if that's what you based it on, you'd think all America's Italian, because we all eat that, right?
Yeah. That is so true.
You know, all these things are so important. You know, that's where it's hard to break some bad habits, because it's so deeply entrenched in us that sometimes the change is hard to do. And, you know, the diversity of those great foods can be good and bad. And, you know, sometimes it might be better for you to have an Indian diet than even our maybe traditional African-American diet, doctor, you know, because we've eaten for many, many years on what we could get and what was best for us based on what was there for us. But it might not have always been the best thing for us.
I'm also impressed with some cultures which have been able to celebrate themselves while still learning the dominant culture. And one good example are the many, many Asian Americans who during the day are great they do nails, they have Chinese and Korean restaurants, they have laundry services, and they have learned the American culture and provide services for the dominant culture, but they go home and speak their languages and practice their culture. So then in many ways, they are bicultural because they were able to practice at home and celebrate themselves while simultaneously helping the dominant culture. And I think that's to be admired. I encourage my young people to love self first. And self-love is not arrogance. Self-love, you can be very modest while loving self, but then because you are comfortable with self, you can reach out and celebrate with others. There are people who are prejudiced, oftentimes don't love themselves. But self-love is not arrogance, but it's an ability to appreciate modestly oneself, but still reaching out and serving others. And that's so important, I think. And that's what these cultures that are collectivistic can do. I once was doing an article on some Asians. And I said, I'm going to celebrate you because you're such a leader. And they said, oh, no. Don't celebrate me. Celebrate the people around me. As a matter of fact, there's a Japanese proverb which says, the nail which stands out gets hammered in. And so we really need to focus on everybody else, understand, listen first, and then try to find ways for what we call win-win. That one way is not the best way, but a way to come together and collaborate. And I think one of the real problems recently in our country is that we got liberals who hate conservatives and conservatives hate liberals. Let's celebrate all of them and find ways to come together. And I think both of you have done that very well. Brian, you are a good example of that in terms of how you handled your work on the council, your social work. You have really helped people celebrate all cultures. And that's so important.
Thank you for that kind word. And go ahead, Rebecca.
I'm sorry to interrupt. I was just going to jump in. You reminded me of something. The Native Americans were very good at cooperative learning. They wouldn't raise their hand because they didn't want to make their fellow classmates feel embarrassed, like they weren't in a hurry to show off that way. So always it's, can you help the person sitting next to you learn this and then raise your hand? That was how it was so good what Dr. Amprey said. And it's like an elder speaking to us because that's what their values were too, is you help move the thing forward and you don't necessarily have to be showing off. So,
We try that in teaching now. We find that students teach themselves better than we professors do.
Absolutely.
Yes. So oftentimes I'll put them in groups get them to come up with a group response. Now it's important that the group share. We can't have one person doing all the work. Mm-hmm. But we find, we learned this from our Asian students who tutor each other. Mm-hmm. Oftentimes, I've taken 20 seconds to say something, and a student can say it in two words in slang. Mm. And he has communicated, and that's the important thing, that they can communicate in such a way that they teach each other. And that's so important in terms of, again, this collectivistic concept.
Right.
And it was taught to us by Asian students, by the way, which is really fascinating.
That is fascinating. Well, that is the value, again, of learning from other cultures and be willing to try it, see if it works.
Yes, we've got to learn to listen better also, to really listen and understand and share. I think sharing is so important in terms of helping others. That's a very important concept.
And I wanted to just continue with those thoughts. And I want to, you know, just say, speaking to our future, you know, and where we're going from here, I just believe, you know, this is a little speed bump. It's a little bump in what we got to take care of as a nation. But it's also a great time of reflection because there's so many things that are relevant now, you know, from health to politics to money to schooling. These issues aren't brand new. They're mm-hmm. just bubbling up right now mm-hmm. when we really need to address them. You know, Rebecca has spoke about teaching and how she taught and where she's at right now in the teaching level. Man, our school system really is getting a real good check right now. And to speak to the visions of the future that I have, it's positivity. Because if we don't have all those voices that may not have had a voice before mm-hmm. at the table to change this, it won't be as good as it can be. And I think it can be now. I think it's ready. We're ready with this hiccup, this speed bump, this little challenge, big challenge. But I think once we get past this, we'll lay a few more layers to success. I really just think when we all come and get back together and realize that we are our first human beings, and then cultural and racial and even global, we're gonna be better off. And when we figure that out, we'll be better off. And there's so much that's underneath that at so many different levels. You know, our whole government right now is what was prepared for with the Constitution. This is how we have the mechanisms to operate for change the right way. It's just we all need to make sure it happens that way. Democracy and individual rights are all being addressed right now. And that's the diversity of what we want for our country in the future. So I'm okay with all this change. We all need to be ready to change. And that's where we're going to have the divide. You know, those of us who are ready and those of us who aren't quite ready yet. You know, it happened before, probably 50 years ago, when we talk about the changes that were made in our country related to civil rights and human rights and women's rights and African-American rights and children's rights. Hey, it wasn't really that far away. And we're in a flash in this pan right now, and we need to get it right, because I personally, as an artist of life, I want diversity. I don't want it the way, just the way I see it, because I'd like to see a canvas of amazing things that I would never even thought of in my own mind. And that's why we all need everyone. We need our community. We need our voices. We need our different everything. And so I champion that, and I really do have a lot of hope for the future.
Good. I do too. But as my supervisors always used to say, keep up the rigor. Okay, we still have some gaps to close. You know, I did my little research here. 33% of Blacks have college degrees. 33%. 40% of whites have college degrees, and 24% of Native Americans. So there's a ways to go yet. So we can sit around and say kumbaya, but let's also be eyes on the prize and don't let anything get in the way of that. And so as usual, you're no child left behind, you know, your minority kids, your single parent homes, this, that, and the other. Help them out, lift them up, push them forward. And it sure, you know, they all have things to contribute.
Speaking of diversity, I'm
not getting distracted by excuses and by lots of other things. We don't need any more of the kind of distractions, because that's all that was a huge lot of distractions. And well meanwhile, said. Some people are putting their hand in their pocket with the money in it. So, you know, and everybody else doesn't get it. So those days are over. They had their turn, and now it's everybody else's turn. And now we've got to do it, and we got to do it right.
Well said. Now, speaking of diversity, because we didn't get our two Hispanics on, I want to remind the viewers that the Hispanic community is very diverse, that the largest Hispanic group is out west, and it's Mexican American, but there are many, many Puerto Ricans and Dominicans and locally. Mm-hmm. There are many Cuban Americans in Florida. There are many Americans from Central America, like Guatemala and Salvador and the DC area. And they're diverse. While they may speak Spanish and eat rice and beans, they have slight, small differences in culture. And many of them are very proud of their own ethnicity, so that when we may say Latino, they may want to say Boricua, or Dominicano, or Salvadoriano. But so let's keep that in mind. And so we don't, and we also, even amongst African Americans, we are not monolithic. There are people of different perspectives, mm-hmm. different values. Right. And we have to cherish those differences and celebrate them rather than let them divide us. We come together and use the term win-win. How can we find ways that we can collaborate and find common ground? That must be a continued approach for all of us. That's so important. I want to ask you a question, Brian, because you are so adaptable. You're a social worker. I suspect that you see clients on Zoom now. You don't see clients as much in person as you did previously. How has that changed your approach in terms of your social work?
That's a great, I mean, it's an adapt and adjust environment that we live in. And it's very difficult. And the reason why it's more difficult is because, as we know, our actual presence makes a difference. You know, right now, we're all about the same size. We're 2 inches tall. But in person, I may be a little bit bigger and a little bit more impactful just with my presence. You know, and when we talk about children, you know, just presence as an adult, it makes a difference. And, you know, that is just one thing from way I look at it, because I deal with a lot of small children and, you know, they're 5 and, you know, between 5 and 7. And when you talk about that, maybe that's what is right now level on the playing field with them. Maybe they feel we're on a better edge when we're together at 2 inches tall. But realistically, when we're there with them, the presence of that, it's a little easier. It's easier for me. But we all got to adapt. And I think that's the name of the name of the game. But a lot of times it's all the basis of what we've been working for anyway. You know, is this really not any difference the way I do therapy? You know, it's really not any difference in the way I'm going to reach out and talk to the children through my communication. It's just a little bit less hands-on. Like, we may be able to play a game of catch physically, and that's where our connection might come from one day. So this way I got to use some different tools. You know, I got to catch some visual and maybe some audio cues before I catch the physical, you know, with catching a ball. So it's, you know, it's adaptability. It's challenging as us, but I couldn't say that it wasn't making me better. It's not making my skills more refined. It's not improving the way I think about working and connecting with the child or the consumer. So, yeah, we're up against a big challenge with COVID-19 and the times, but diversity, positivity, continuing to maintain some of the anchors and the foundations that we already have. We can't just quit them. We can't just throw everything that we've already built away. We just got to adapt it and make it work for as many as we can.
Another question for you, Brian, because you were vice president of the city council, you were a councilman. Are there any things locally in terms of navigating the city that you want to pass on to us in terms of trash collection or voting registration or anything?
Just want to tell everybody to be involved. And, you know, originally we had some people of Latino descent that were going to speak on the program times, collaboration times, and everything got mixed up, so they weren't able to attend. But, you know, we sit in a very highly populated Latino city, as evidence from our new mayor, Eddie Moran, and also are going to be state representative-elect Manny Guzman. So, you know, right there in that small little pocket, we're showing representations at the higher level of the democratic structure or level of our city and our state. So we're moving well in that direction. I mean, things are changing. I want to pass on to people to try and just stay connected. Even me, who knows how to navigate the whole city and knows how everything works on council, it's a little bit different now because City Hall's closed. There's different ways to get at things, but let's not isolate ourselves. Let's not make ourselves an island. Anyone can reach out to me if they see me on this program and have a question and are unsure about how to get to someone. I'm councilmanbrian@gmail.com. And if you ask someone else on how to get to me, you could get my phone number. I'd be happy to try and help you. But we need to make sure that we're keeping involvement in our local system, because even though it's slowed down, the system hasn't stopped. You know, it's still functioning. We still have to make ordinances. They still need to make sure that all of our utilities in the city is still running. So the city's not running with everybody in it, but it's still working and it's still going. And I personally don't know all the mechanisms, but I'm just wishing those in charge well and just good discretionary decisions and positive, things for the future. If they need me, I hopefully they give me a call. But I'm just here the same as anyone else as a citizen, hoping that we can keep our city going safe and, you know, open up the economics as soon as possible. And I just know it's safety first, and I understand that.
Thank you very much. We're almost out of time. I want to thank Councilman Brian Twyman and Ms. Rebecca Reppert for being on the program. If you want to see this program again, you're watching it at 8 p.m. on Monday. It's available at 10 a.m. on Wednesday, at 3 p.m. next Friday, at noon the following Sunday, and beginning Wednesday, you can see it anytime by going to bctv.org and scroll down to the 8 p.m. time on Monday. Also, for the viewers, I haven't completely finished my agenda for my January program. Please reach out to me. You're going to see at the end my address and email number. You can get me at that point. Thank you very much. God bless. Good night.
Special programs on BCTV are supported by the following. Keystone Property and Asset Management provides expert care of industrial, office, retail, and medical sites. With more than 4 million square feet managed, Keystone knows how to save you money.